Welcome to the summit about your true nature, peace and freedom. And now I'll be speaking to Leonard Jacobson about our true nature. He calls it presence. And in his book, Journey into Now, Clear Guidance on the Path of Spiritual Awakening, he elaborates on that. And it's a beautiful book where he really goes into depth about everything. And Leonard, can you talk to me about this presence that you say is here now, and also how the whole ego can be integrated or dissolved or dismantled or embraced, whatever you want to say about that. But I like that you have that whole dimension of also facing what we actually are now as well, this mind story.
Okay, so really what I'm teaching is a very clear and direct path of awakening. And so we have to ask ourselves, what do I mean by awakening? What are we awakening from? What are we awakening to? And we're awakening from a very limited level of consciousness called the world of the mind. It's actually made up of the remembered past, all your memories from the past, all your imaginings and fantasies into the future, together with all your ideas, your concepts, your opinions, and your beliefs. And it all gives you a sense of who you are when you're living within the mind. The only problem is that the mind is like a computer. And like any computer, it can only run according to its programming. So we have to ask ourselves, how has the mind been programmed? And what is the effect of that? What are the consequences of that in relation to our day-to-day life? So we really have to begin with the question, if your question is what is our true nature, in a way we have to begin with what is not our true nature, what is in a sense our false nature. And this applies to when we're living within the world of the mind. Now, because it's a computer, and it contains all the past programming, that past program begins in very, very early childhood. It actually begins in the womb. It actually begins in previous lifetimes, but I'm not going to go into that during this conversation. Let's just stick to this lifetime. And when you were born, when all of us were born, you came out of the womb, your mother's womb, as a very, very present little being. And you've just been through an incredibly traumatic experience called birth. And what you need to do, what you need as you enter the world, you need your mother and father to be incredibly present with you. If they're very present with you, you'll relax. You'll realize, oh, wow, this is okay. I've just moved to a larger womb. The old womb was getting too small. Now I have a much larger womb. So if we could relax, we wouldn't go through the process that we've all been through, the journey that we've all been on in getting ourselves lost. So what are those limiting beliefs? Because it very much plays into your question, what is our true nature? But then before we get to our true nature, we have to recognize what has happened to us. Who have we become other than our true nature, living in a world where no one is present? Who have we become? So let's look at those limiting beliefs because they're fundamentally important. The earliest and deepest limiting beliefs form within us. They begin as an impression and slowly form into a belief that gets programmed into the mind. So the first and the deepest ones are, I'm all alone. There's no one here. I'm abandoned. I feel separate. I don't feel safe. That's kind of the beginning of the programming of the mind, and it's completely legitimate because it's true. There's no one here. If they're not here, if your mother and father are not really here, not present, then where are they? They're lost themselves in the past and future world of the mind. That is true for almost everyone on planet Earth, lost within the world of the mind, governed by these limiting beliefs, trying to improve the dream that they're lost in. So let's continue with the limiting beliefs because it's so important. Because there's no one present and you feel separate and you don't feel safe, then you start what I call the pursuit of the substitute needs. I need you to, if you're not present, I don't feel safe. I need you to be present with me, but you're not. Will you at least love me? Will you love me unconditionally? But we don't get that. And so we feel all the pain around not being loved unconditionally. Okay, the second substitute need, will you at least accept me unconditionally? We don't get that either. So then we go for the third and final substitute need, which is, will you at least acknowledge me? Think I'm special. Look how important I am. Look how pretty I am. Look at my new dress, my new car, my new home. And it's all designed to avoid the pain of feeling separate, which is what we experience at a very deep unconscious level. And all of this goes to define who you are when you're living within the world of the mind. All your limiting beliefs are going to affect every aspect of your life and every aspect of your relationships. And so as long as these limiting beliefs are unconscious, they're going to have really quite a negative and difficult effect on your life. For example, if you don't feel loved, if that's one of your limiting beliefs from childhood, because your parents didn't really know how to express love because they never got it themselves, then if you have that limiting belief that you are loved, that you are not loved, you're going to spend the rest of your life looking for love. And the problem is the limiting belief that you're not loved is not true. So you've spent your whole life pursuing something based on an illusion, a non-truth. It's just an impression that formed within the mind, given the circumstances of your life. Now, on top of that, we have all these difficult feelings that arise in our childhood. Anger, you're not allowed to be angry. You don't know what to do with the anger. Hurt, sadness, pain. Needs that are not being met, and fear. At the deepest level, fear of not surviving, fear of dying. So all of these limiting beliefs, all of these feelings, which we then repress, right? It's all making up our sense of who we are. So when you ask, what is our true nature? It's not that. But most of us are locked and imprisoned within the mind. And so in a sense, we're defined by what I'm describing, all the limiting beliefs, the repressed feelings, all the judgments of yourself and others, all your opinions, your beliefs, it all gives you a sense of who you are. The problem is, it's not the truth of who you are. It's who you are when you're caught in a remembered past and an imagined future. It's not the truth of who you are. So how do you awaken into the truth of who you are?
Yeah, that's I'm very curious about that because it sounds... like the good stuck in this limited story, and it doesn't sound very thrilling if you can have a life that is much more alive.
Of course. So the question is, well, how do we free ourselves from this world of the mind, which is also a world of illusion and separation? It's not real. It's made up of memory and imagining. It's the past and the future. So and it's a world of separation and illusion, this world of the mind, the dream, the story, all the same. So how do we free ourselves from the past and future world of the mind? It's so simple. Is it okay with you if it's very simple? I'll take that to be yes. Okay. So in order to come out of the past and future world of the mind, you just bring yourself present with something that is here in the moment with you. If you can see it, hear it, feel it, touch it, taste it, smell it in this moment, you can be present with it. The moment you're truly present with something that is in the moment with you, you come out of the mind, out of the past and future, out of the dream, out of the separation, out of the illusion. Now you're present. And as long as you remain present with something that is here in the moment, then the dream is not with you. It's not here. The limiting beliefs are not here. The repressed feelings are not here. The judgments are not here. Now, as you open into presence, you start to experience an entirely different dimension of you, which is indeed your true nature. As you become present, first of all, the first thing that happens is that your mind starts to calm down, quieten down, because and eventually your mind will fall silent. So you'll have a silent mind unless you're choosing to think consciously. So you open into silence. You open into peace. Peace is probably the strongest feeling that you experience when you're present in your true nature. So it's silence, peace, but also it gets more interesting than that. When you are present, you are the energy of love. There's nothing you can do about it. It has nothing to do with who or what you love. It's like when you light a candle and it gives off a glow of light. When you're present, you give off a glow of love and a glow of presence, and people can feel it and they respond. When you're present, you are quite literally the energy of acceptance. There's no judgment in you. You just accept the moment as it is. There's no conflict, no struggle, no trying. You're just here relaxing into the present moment, present with what is here, and enjoying the moment beautifully. So when you're present, you are the energy of compassion. Now, it gets even more interesting. As you settle and relax and become more deeply present, you start to open into oneness. You start to feel and sense the oneness that is in everything. The illusion of separation that you've lived with all your life and all the strategies you've developed to escape that feeling of being separate, it all dissolves as you start to open into oneness. But then, as you become even more deeply present, you start to sense the presence of God in all things present. And at the very deepest level of presence, heaven on earth is revealed within your consciousness. It's not revealed for everyone. It's just revealed for you as you open into that very deep level of awakened consciousness where God is, where truth is, where love is, where heaven on earth is revealed. So that's the true, that's your true nature. You are actually your true nature. I'll tell you your true nature. You are actually an eternal being. That's who you really are. But, and you're an eternal being living lifetime after lifetime, lost within the dream. And the whole point of your journey is to actually free yourself from the dream and awaken into the truth of who you are.
Yeah. How come it that most of us don't seem to awaken? It appears like most of us in the world are lost in that mind, in the ego, in the limiting beliefs, in the thoughts, memories, imaginations of future, all that. Why is it that we are not just our true nature naturally? You talked about how we grow up and it comes upon us basically from everywhere. But somewhere it feels like it should be more simple just to really be who we truly are.
Well, it is simple. It's incredibly simple. On the other hand, there are so many forces of resistance, and I'll talk about those forces of resistance. First of all, would you like to know how many lifetimes you and everyone viewing this has been lost living within the world of the mind? Probably forever, probably from the moment you entered the world of time and the world of duality. We are so deeply habituated to living within the world of the mind. It's what we're used to. It's kind of our home. It's where we live. We talk from here. We live from here. We relate to others from within the mind, which is all an illusory world of separation. But we're deeply habituated to that. Now, the other thing to make it even worse is that we humans, humanity, has become completely addicted to thinking, and we can't stop. It's the greatest addiction. It's a stronger addiction than being addicted to alcohol, sex, heroin, or anything else. It's an addiction that afflicts the whole of humanity. And even trying to stop thoughts will strengthen the thoughts. So you need a very clear and precise way to guide you through the maze that is the world of the mind. Because there's quicksand at every step, basically. If you step off the path, you're going to get lost in so many different ways. But, you know, the way is clear and narrow, as Jesus said, and few there are that find it. It's very precise, becoming present. So they're the main reasons why it's so difficult. But there's a third and equally significant reason. When you're in the mind, and you believe in your thoughts and you're kind of lost in that world of past and future, that's where you live. It's a world of separation and illusion, but then it's like being imprisoned within the world of the mind. The truth is almost everyone is imprisoned within the world of the mind. And I'll tell you how you put yourself in the prison. You put yourself in the prison by believing in your thoughts, by believing in your beliefs, by believing in your opinions as somehow being true. So you put yourself in the prison, but once you're in the prison, there is a very powerful prison warden who has no intention of releasing you into your true nature. And that prison warden is your ego. Now, the ego is not the enemy. You can't defeat the ego. You can't get rid of the ego, but you need to have very clear answers to certain questions about the ego if you're going to free yourself from the ego's dominance in your life. For example, what is the ego? Nobody really knows. What is the ego's role in your life? When does it come into your life? What is its function? How does it function? Why does it resist you being present? And how can you overcome its resistance? These are questions that have not been answered anywhere throughout history, these particular questions. And they must be answered if we're to truly awaken into our true nature. So that's the second obstacle. Another obstacle to answer your question, why is it not easy to become present? Why are we all stuck in the mind?
Yeah.
Very simple. One word, I'll tell you one word. Judgment. As long as you're involved in judgment, you remain imprisoned within the separate world of the mind. There's no way out. Judgment inevitably and invariably will take you back into separation, because the awakened state of presence is without judgment. God is without judgment. So these are the things we need to start bringing into consciousness. How does my ego resist, pull me out of presence and resist presence? You have to come into right relationship with the ego. What are the limiting beliefs that have been running me all my life? What are the repressed feelings still repressed within my body? How do I liberate those repressed feelings? How do I bring the limiting beliefs to consciousness? How do I recognize when a judgment is arising and not get caught in it? All of these things are necessary to free yourself from this dream state that you're lost in, a world of the past and future. But it's a part of the process of awakening. I call it step two of this teaching. Step one is learning the art of being present, settling into presence, relaxing into presence, becoming familiar with what it feels like to be present. Step two involves bringing conscious awareness to all the ways that you're pulled out of presence. What are the obstacles to your awakening? Who are you when you're lost in the mind compared to who are you in your true nature? You must be able to recognize those two dimensions and stop believing in the illusory dimension and slowly, slowly relax into the truth of who you are. So there's a lot involved in your question, and it's all a part of this teaching. It can't be explained clearly or simply without experience. In my retreats and workshops, people have an opportunity to directly experience what I'm sharing with you here. And it's very important to experience it for yourself. People don't know what I mean by presence when I use the word presence or be present until you actually experience it directly yourself. You don't really know what it is. You have to experience it. And then once you experience it, you know. Simple. And then you'll be able to identify or detect, am I present in this moment, or am I still in the world of the mind, the dream, the story? Because they're radically different. They're completely different dimensions of who you are.
Yeah. So also when you're in that presence, then all the thoughts and ideas and perceptions and such can kind of be revealed, that how they come and go, and they're not really you because they come and go. And also all those emotions that we have, that maybe we have had them our whole lives, and somehow a lot of them are repressed throughout life. We don't even know we have them. We don't even know where they're from. But if we're resting, relaxing in our presence, and that can kind of bubble up to the surface?
Not really, but it's kind of like that. But you see, when you're present, presence is a transcendent dimension. To become present is to transcend the past and future world of the mind, transcend the story, the dream. Now, it's a transcendent perspective. And it's from this transcendent perspective that you can witness whatever arises within the mind, whether it's a repressed feeling suddenly triggered, whether it's a thought or a limiting belief or a judgment, whether it's the subtle manipulations of the ego to pull you out of presence. Because presence is a transcendent dimension, you can be a witness to it all without being involved in it. But it's very important also that you come into the right relationship with your thoughts, your feelings, with the ego, with the inner child, with the judgments as they arise, with the thoughts themselves. We have to come into right relationship with all of it. Most people don't know this. Now, what is right relationship with the ego, the feelings, the thoughts, the limiting beliefs? What is right relationship? Let me begin by saying that the only way to come into right relationship is to first become present. Because when you're present, you are love, acceptance, compassion, and allowing. There's no judgment. That's the energy you bring to the thoughts, to the feelings, to the ego, to the inner child. All of it is basically, you bring that energy of love, acceptance, compassion, allowing to all of it. And slowly, slowly, it begins to relax. Like that's what's been missing. You know, it's been missing. So when the ego, first the ego won't trust it. This can't be real. What is this? I'm not used to this. Love and acceptance. What's this? I'm not used to being allowed. What's this, says the ego. But slowly, slowly, it'll start to relax. It won't happen all at once. But as you come into right relationship with the ego, it will begin to relax and it'll begin to surrender the reins of control. Very important. You also have to be in right relationship with the repressed feelings that have been with you since you were a child. You have to know how to allow anger to complete its journey through you, or to allow the energy of pain, hurt, sadness to complete its journey through you. It's not therapy. It's something completely different to therapy. It's allowing these feelings to complete their journey. It's liberating these feelings from being repressed within your body, which is not healthy for you or the feelings. So it's all part of the overall approach to awakening that I share with people.
Yeah.
There's so much involved.
Yeah. And sometimes when there is so much involved, it seems like it's an impossible journey, or it's impossible to ever just be my true nature. But at the same time, my true nature is also that, right? So that's why it's like all that is welcome.
If you believe it's an impossible journey, then it will be. Because yeah. That's just a thought. It's not true. It's actually not true. It's a thought. You have to be aware of all your thoughts and watch what they're doing. You know, to believe it's an impossible journey means you'll never awaken. If you change that to, it's a piece of cake, I've got this, it won't take long. And to be present, you've got to recognize that to be present is so incredibly and absurdly simple. I notice I'm thinking, no problem, I'm allowed to think if I want, but I also have a choice. When I notice I'm thinking, I can shift my focus. Now I'm present with something that's here in the moment with me. It really doesn't matter what it is. It could be anything. It doesn't matter. It could be a pair of glasses. It doesn't matter what it is. Okay. As long as I really bring myself present with something that is here. The moment I'm truly present with these glasses or this box, the moment I'm truly present with just one part of it, suddenly my mind is silent. I'm here now. Now I don't have to stay with the box. Now, wherever I look, whatever I do, I'm present because I took myself out of the mind, out of the past and future. Now I'm present, and I will remain present now until I get caught again back into the mind.
Yeah. And then you can just get back, or not get back, but you can just say, oh, I'll be present again now. I got lost in my mind stream, but I can choose to be present again.
Well, I wouldn't even say that, because again, that's too many words. It's just, you're just thinking and then present.
Yeah.
You've got to keep it very, very simple. No trying. If you try to be present, you'll never be present. If you practice presence, you're not going to become present. Because it's too simple. How I like to put it is this: the present moment is already here. That's it. You can't make it go away and you can't add to it. The present moment, whatever is in the present moment with you, is already here. So why would you seek something that is already here? Why would you try to find something that's already here? Instead of seeking and trying, you relax and just gently, very gently, you notice you're thinking, no problem, very relaxed. Now you bring yourself present with something that is in the moment with you. If you can see it, you can be present with it. If you can hear it, all the senses. But you can also close your eyes and be very present with your body breathing. Your body can only breathe in the present moment.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're present with the body, really present, not half-heartedly present, you're really present with the body breathing, then any moment, now this is important, any moment you're truly present, you are an awakened being. That's it. Just like Buddha, just like Buddha, just like Jesus, any moment you're truly present, you are an awakened being. Your mind is silent. You feel the peace. You are the love, the acceptance, the compassion. At the deepest level, you are pure consciousness, an eternal silent presence of pure consciousness. Now, I would like to know, how can the eternal silent presence of pure consciousness that you are, when you're deeply present, be any different than the pure, silent, pure consciousness of Buddha or Jesus when they're present? This is where we open into oneness. Buddha and Jesus never intended to put themselves up here out of reach. They're trying to reveal to us who we really are. Buddha, if Buddha could speak to you, Buddha would say, have you forgotten who you are? Have you become lost in your dream? Jesus would say, all that I am, you are. Awaken from your dream.
Yeah. Yeah. And somehow a lot of us have gotten lost in all these pointers, like what...
Not a lot of us, not a lot of us, everyone.
Yeah.
Well, most everyone, I should say everyone. And it's very subtle. The way, I really like the words of Jesus, the way is narrow and few there are that find it. Because it's through the doorway of the present moment. You have to come to the present moment as it is. The present moment is not going to adapt or adjust itself to suit your preferences. You come to the present moment as it is, which is simple as saying, bring yourself present with something that is here and then be responsive. It's not complicated. Anything you think about it is not it. I can see you're thinking, but that's not it. You can't know it with the mind. You cannot know presence with the mind. Now, if I was to guide you into a deeper level of presence now, you would love it. You would open up, you'd be radiant, a radiant, beautiful light upon planet Earth, but you would be no longer able to conduct this interview.
Yeah. So if you're always in that presence, mm-hmm. then can you function in the world? Because if you like just are so fully in the moment and it's all, and there are no thoughts, right? If you're fully in it, there are actually no thoughts, right? And how can you function in the world?
It's a good question. The answer is at the deepest levels of presence, where you're completely open in oneness, one with God, the mystery, no thoughts, no past, no future, no story, no dream. The answer is you cannot function in the world at that very deep level of presence. And I am speaking from experience. I know what I'm talking about. You would need one or two caretakers to manage you and make sure you don't get yourself into trouble and make sure you eat and make sure you drink and take care of you. Now, if that happens to you, probably in the West, nobody's going to know what to do with you. So you'd have to get on the first plane to India and find a nice cave to sit in and a nice begging bowl. Now, that's the extreme awakening into presence. And I've spent months in that state of consciousness that I'm describing. But something is also possible, which I believe is essential for humanity and the awakening of consciousness at this time. We need to learn how to integrate this amazing opening into awakened consciousness, eternal, infinite consciousness, pure consciousness. We need to be able to integrate it into the human that I am. In other words, there's a process of integration you can go through. Now I can play in the world of time. I can enjoy my life. I can go out with friends and have dinner or coffee. I can do sessions like this, no problem. But at any moment, I can step out of it all. And now I'm back into the eternal.
Yeah. So it's a matter of a choice. We can make a choice. Do we want to just rest in our true essence, and or do we want to get caught up in the mind stream? At one point, it can become a matter of choice.
Not really a choice. It's something that the integration that I'm describing happens organically. It's organic. I remember when, I guess at some level it is a choice. I'm not sure how to answer that, but I can share with you from my own story, if you like. I was in this state that I'm describing for several months, where I was just sitting in a cabin in the forest, or lying in the bed in the forest, in the cabin, and being one with the trees and one with everything there around me. No thought, no past, no future, just divine oneness and complete and total immersion into isness, into the moment of now. And this went on for quite a long time. People would bring me food. If you asked me a question about me when I was in this state, I didn't know who you were talking about. I didn't exist as a separate individual. I could have answered a question about you, but not about me. I couldn't have told you anything about me outside of this moment, because there was nothing of me outside of this moment. After about 3 months, the words bubbled up from within me. Now, this is not a choice. The words bubbled up. No one will come. They were the words that bubbled up after 3 months in this state that I was in. And somehow that initiated my descent from the mountain. The mountain meaning the mountain of consciousness that I was on. I decided, if no one will come to me, then I have to come down from this mountain, integrate the awakened consciousness as I do. And then if no one will come to me, then I will come to you. I will find you. And I've spent the last 40 years finding those who are ready. Or they find me. Either way, whether I find them or they find me. And then it's not special. I'm not presenting myself as a guru or anything like that. I'm simply a guide on the path of awakening. And the two-step teaching that has evolved over the years, this two-step teaching is like a very clear roadmap on the path of awakening. It's just point by point roadmap and very clear guidance on the path of awakening. But again, as Jesus said, Jesus knew that what he was sharing back then, 2000 years ago, he knew it was not for everyone. That's why he would say, for those with ears to hear, for those with eyes to see. He knew not everyone would respond. And it's the same today. My role, and other people like me, my role is to get the teaching out as much as possible, which what we're doing here is one way to do that, right? What we're doing together. But then those who are ready to respond or feeling want to respond, they feel drawn to respond to what I'm sharing, then they can respond. If it doesn't relate to them, they can throw it away. I don't care. I have no attachment to outcome. I'm not trying to persuade or anyone of anything or convince anyone of anything. In fact, you can't. People have to get to it on their own. You have to, something within you. It's really coming from the soul dimension. Something within you is longing for homecoming, for the truth, for a return to oneness. And when that longing for oneness, for truth, for love, for God, it's emanating from the soul. You may not be aware that's where it's coming from, but when it's coming from the soul dimension, you have no choice but to embark upon this path and wake yourself up. And the very interesting thing is, when you wake yourself up in this lifetime, when you free yourself from the dream, the soul is freed with you. The soul wakes up with you. Every realm and dimension of your multi-dimensional existence awakens with you. In this way, you are the champion of your own soul. And the only one that can awaken the soul is you in this lifetime. If you miss in this lifetime, no problem. God will give you another chance in the next lifetime. You know, it's lifetime after lifetime. We have yet another opportunity to free ourselves from the dream, but most of us fail miserably in freeing ourselves from the dream, in opening up into our true nature. Yeah. In our true nature, we're empowered from within. It's true power. When we're in the mind, lid governed by the ego, it's false power. We have power over others, or others have power over us. That's false power. But can you imagine how much your life changes when you open into the true nature of love, the true nature of acceptance, the true nature of power? And at the deepest level, the true nature of power is love. So it's all beautiful, and it all makes sense at so many levels. You couldn't make this up. You couldn't create, you couldn't write a movie script about who we really are and how we got to this point and what is needed for us to open up into our true nature. You couldn't imagine.
Yeah. So it's here and now, the present, right? The presence is present here and now.
And well, there is only here and now.
Yeah, like right now, like this.
There's nothing outside of this moment.
Right.
That's the dream.
Yes.
What you had this morning for breakfast is part of your dream. What you're going to do when you finish this interview is part of your dream. Even the next question you're going to ask me is part of your dream. The only life really available to us is this moment. Everything else is the dream. I'm not saying the dream has to go away. I'm not saying don't play in the dream. Just stop getting lost in the dream. Open up into the truth of who you are, the truth of life, revealed through the present moment. That's all I'm saying. The dream can stay, you can still think, but now you know where the truth is.
Yeah. And the dream is also a miracle. It's a mystery, right? There's nothing wrong with the dream. It's just how we're relating to the dream.
No, it's not a miracle at all, and it's not a mystery. The truth of who you are is a mystery. And the truth of who you are is a miracle. The real miracle is to awaken out of the dream into your true nature, into the truth of who you are. That's the miracle.
Yeah.
The dream, it's an incredibly complex network of thoughts and concepts and ideas and opinions and memories and imaginings and hopes and dreams and fears and desires. All of this is your dream that gives you a sense of who you are and what your life is all about. But none of it is true.
Right. So, but there is a reality. So
it's not reality. No, it's not real. I can't let you get away with that. It's not. If you want reality, the only reality available to you is this moment.
Yes.
So if you're fully present with something in the moment, then you're in reality.
Yeah. And that reality is heaven on earth, right? When you're in this moment, then it's like you're really, you feel everything, or you are one with everything.
At that level of presence, absolutely, yes, true.
Yeah, and then it becomes heaven on earth, everything.
The what?
Then everything becomes heaven on earth. Like, you love the mountains, you love the trees, you love the people, you love yourself.
Everything is included when you're present. Love, the love that arises from presence is more like the moon casting its light in a clear evening. The moon shines its light on all without discrimination or selection. It's not picking who to shine its light on. The moon can't help it. It just shines its light. You can't help it. You just radiate love. It's not even directed. Of course, there are people that you would love in a personal sense, but this is an impersonal sense of love. It's a transcendent love. It's the truth of who you are. It's the energy of who you are. It doesn't really matter who or what you love. You look at the tree, love is looking at the tree. You look at the flower, love is looking at the flower. You look at the dog or the cat, love is looking. You look at the car parked on the side of the road, love is looking. If you're present, you would be amazed what happens with people when I bring them present with something as simple as a door handle. A humble door handle. All of a sudden, they're opening into oneness. They recognize the beauty of the door handle. They feel love for the door handle. They feel so much peace. Now, the door handle could be anything. It doesn't have to be beautiful or pretty. Anything will do. Everything that is in the present moment with you is inviting you to be present with it. Every leaf moving on every tree, when you go for a walk, you see the leaves moving on the trees. Every leaf is waving to you. It's saying, here I am. I am here. Will you be present with me? Or is your dream so interesting that you want to stay in your dream?
Yeah.
But we don't respond to the invitation. We just keep ignoring it. Even people on a path of enlightenment, don't bother me, tree. Don't bother me, flower. I'm trying to get enlightened.
Yeah. And it also is because we feel like, oh, I know all this. I know the world. I know this person, that I know, my couch. I mean, what's so special about it? So it's like the mind just puts labels on everything and say, I know it. And then we don't really know. We don't know. It's a new moment, right? It's
absolutely right. You're completely correct. That's what the mind and the ego does. I don't need to look at that tree. I know it. I've already seen a tree. I know what a tree is. Whereas if you really become present with the tree, really become present with it, you'll recognize that it's much more than a tree. In fact, what I like to say is that's not really a tree. It's God in the form of a tree, or it's God in the form of a chair or a door handle or a flower or a dog. Your own body is God in the form of that body. And suddenly your whole relationship with what is here changes, because you start to honor. How can you not honor the body of God? Everything in physical form is the body of God. Bring yourself present with the body of God, and you'll begin to sense and experience the living presence of God in all things present. This has nothing to do with religion, nothing to do with believing in God. In fact, to believe in God is an obstacle to knowing God. Those who want to know God have to surrender not just believing in God, but all belief. All belief is false and illusory. You can still have your beliefs, but don't regard them as true. Just enjoy your beliefs. They're not true. Your thoughts are not true. Don't pay them too much attention. So what is true? If none of that is true, what is true? Just this moment, and you fully present in this moment. Only that is the truth.
Yeah. And nothing has to happen in that moment. It's like
nothing has to happen.
I have to. But it's
that,
like,
that would be coming from the story. That would be coming from the ego.
Yeah.
Now, that doesn't mean that you remain sitting and never move. What happens is, as you become present and relax into presence, you start to become responsive to the present moment. So you might be sitting in total bliss, total ecstasy, totally enjoying the moment, not moving. All of a sudden, the feeling arises, oh, I'm going to go for a walk. So you go for a walk. Or I'd like to meet with a friend and have coffee, no problem. Or the rain starts, so, oh, I'll reach for an umbrella. You don't have to think about it much, you know. You're responding moment to moment to what's going on in the moment and to the feelings that are arising in the moment, not from the past.
Yeah. And how do we know if it's the feelings that arise are in the moment or from the past?
Okay.
And do we need to know the difference? Does it matter?
Oh, yes. Yeah, most definitely. Well, first of all, if the feelings are arising in the moment, they're going to be incredibly simple and not take you over. So for example, and they're always instructive. It's like the feelings arising in the moment have a message. For example, what is the feeling of hunger telling you?
Hunger, yeah. Yeah, I want to eat, yeah.
What is the feeling of thirst telling you?
I need to drink.
What is the feeling you feel a bit lonely? What is that telling you?
It would be nice for some company.
So you call a friend, would you like to meet for a coffee or for lunch? No big deal. Okay, you're out with friends, they're all talking too loudly, you really want to be off on your own, you feel overwhelmed by all the talk. What is that telling you? Time to leave. It's not complicated. Feelings like anger belong to the dream. Hurt, sadness, pain belong to the dream, and they're from the past. Nobody can hurt you. I'll tell you some very simple truths. No one can hurt you unless you have hurt repressed within you from the past. Then all that's happening is they're triggering the hurt that's already there. No one can make you angry unless you have anger repressed within you from your past, mostly from childhood, or even past lives. But that's all that's ever happening is they're triggering feelings that are already there waiting to be triggered. So when somebody triggers you or makes you angry or hurts your feelings, you should say to them, thank you. And they'll say, why? And you'll say, because you've given me an opportunity to bring awareness to the feelings repressed within me that have just been triggered. I'm going to go home, kill you three times, and then let it go. That's how you've got to learn how to liberate those repressed feelings. Not believe in them, but liberate them. And don't project your past onto the present.
Yeah.
And again, yeah, this is all part of the teaching. And it really is much simpler than it might sound if you're not familiar with this. It's actually quite fun and quite joyful waking up. It's joyful. It's fun. It's the best journey there is. Yeah. The inner journey. Like what I say to people is, be an explorer of yourself. Who are you at the level of mind? What are the limiting beliefs? Who have you become? How's your inner child doing, stuck within this story? What's going on with the ego? What about judgments? Get to know who you are at the level of mind without judging it or trying to fix it. It's more about revealing who you are to the presence dimension of you, who you've become to the presence dimension of you.
Yeah. And the more that you are living in the presence, in the present moment, the more you seem to also automatically live from that space. Like in the beginning, you may feel like you constantly get lost in the mind stream, but then the more you become aware of your presence, the more it seems to be your auto setting. Is that
you're absolutely right. In the early stages of liberation, you know, you might spend a minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, half an hour in presence. It feels beautiful. But then somebody will say something or do something, something will happen that triggers you and pulls you back into the story. Now you're caught in the dream. That's step one, being present. Now you're caught. So that's when you need step two. How did that happen? What is it unhealed within me? What hook is still in me that allows me to be hooked like that? And slowly, slowly, you arise in mastery of your mind and ego. Slowly, slowly, your mind and ego relax and you find it easier and easier to be present. And then one day, you can't know exactly when that day will come. But one day you might wake up in the morning and suddenly everything looks different. Everything seems different because there's been a shift. There's been a shift in your home. Suddenly, because of all the work you've been doing to wake yourself up, suddenly you have a new home. Your old home before this moment was the world of your mind. You have moments in presence, but you just are pulled automatically back to the mind because that's where you live. But once this shift occurs, your new home is the world of now. You can still use your mind, no problem. But then when you're finished thinking, automatically you just come back here. This is where you live. I play in the world of time, but I am not of the world of time. Then which world are you of, sir? I am of the world of now. This is my home. This is where the truth of life is, the truth of love, the truth of who I am. It's all here, revealing itself through the present moment. The present moment is the doorway to oneness, to God, to heaven on earth. It reveals my true nature, the truth of who I am. It's not that complicated and it's so worthwhile. But most people are afraid. They're afraid of the unknown. They're afraid of letting go. They're so used to living a routine life that it shakes them up too much to contemplate another dimension of who they are. And one other thing I'd say, if we're talking about your true nature, in this moment right now, you are a multidimensional being. You exist right now simultaneously at the heavenly realm, the spiritual realm, the soul realm, the physical realm, the psychic realm, the astral realm. It's all here right now. But you're only tuned in to one small dimension of it, which is that dimension that you know yourself as, within the mind, based in the past, based in the future, within the dream. Everyone is lost in this dream state, not realizing that they're lost in a dream. You don't realize you're lost in a dream until you awaken from the dream.
Yeah. Wow. This was amazing. All this. Thank you so much, Leonard. Can you talk to me about your website, your books? I don't know if you have any books right there you can show, but tell us about how can people get in contact with you? Okay. And
okay, well, there's a number of books. There's Words from Silence, Embracing the Present, and Bridging Heaven and Earth. Those three books I regard as a kind of trilogy, and they're written really for the awakened you. So when you're open in presence, those books are perfect for you. They're really written from within the mystery and they just touch you at a very deep, deep level. Just reading the books can open you up into oneness or God. They're very mystical books. Journey Into Now is the one you've read, which is a much more comprehensive and detailed guide to the Path of Awakening. That's the book I recommend people read first and let that guide them into the deeper levels of presence, then read the other three books. But you can read them in any order. Then there's a children's book that I wrote called In Search of the Light, which is beautifully illustrated. It's a great book. And that's actually the first book I ever wrote. Not the first book that was published, but the first book I wrote. I think that's it. I'm currently working on other books. There's also an incredibly interesting play that you can access through my website called Liberating Jesus. Have you seen that?
Yes, I saw it and I love it.
Yeah, people should really, unless you're a born again Christian, everyone should watch that video of the play. I wrote the play, I performed it. It's a one man play called Liberating Jesus, and I play the role of Jesus returned to planet Earth now today. And what would Jesus have to say if he came back today? And he, truthfully, he's not that pleased. So he's got a lot to say from the stage. So that's also available to people. I'm working on a book about that as well. And so there's so much on offer for people that are really interested. And
sessions and workshops, right? You have sessions and workshops?
Oh, we do online events. We have, at the moment, because of COVID, we're not doing our regular workshops, but I run retreats, workshops. We have online events. We have webcasts. There's so much. So in order to find out what's really available through this teaching, just go to the website leonardjacobson.com and it's all there, including a detailed description of the awakenings that I went through back in 1981 and onwards.
Okay. Thank you so much, Leonard. I appreciate it so much. It was beautiful. And all this information, I think it's going to be very beneficial for a lot of people. It was for me.
Great. Yeah, okay. Well, look, thank you for inviting me to be here with you and to share with you. So I appreciate it. And I send love and blessings to everyone who views this video.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.